Thank you. Be with those, dear Lord, who could not be with us, and have them to return, as it be thy will. Dear Lord, help us to keep our eyes, our ears, our hearts, and our minds open to the words of the Psalms, the words from your book of the Bible, and from our message today. Be with us, dear Lord, as we go out into next week, and help us keep all of these things in our minds and hearts until then. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our opening hymn is number 581. If you want to use your book, otherwise it's on the screen. Church to the family. Also, I want to make note particularly that the baby dedication is scheduled for Sunday, October the 2nd. Please get in touch with Helen Daniel and Deborah Craven if you have the name. Prayer concerns are listed on the back. This morning we have already added several. We have added for the prayer list Darby Polhammer. And we've also added the family of Glenn Walker. And we have added two praises. Sharon Jones is much better. And with a little background story here, the board voted to cut down 9 trees that were hanging over the parsonage and probably causing some damage to the roof. Those trees are now on the ground. The parsonage is intact. The garage is intact. And Randy and Robbie and Wayne are intact. So we have them all. Okay? Yay. For the trees. Okay. So are there any others to add for the prayers?
I'd like to add Bobby and Olivia Finch's youngest son.
Gunter. Bobby and Olivia Finch's son. Gunter. To the prayer list. We will now have the meditation and morning prayer. After which we will have the communion hymn, number 460.
Spirit. share with those that we love and adore, and help each of us to be ministers of what you've given us, so that we may spread it throughout our community and throughout the world. We ask now that you bless this bread and this cup that we're about to take together. Help us to nourish us further to be disciples of your word here on this earth. For Christ's sake, amen. Christ gathered in the upper room with his disciples. He broke the bread. He broke the bread. He blessed it and asked each of them to remember his broken body when they partake of it. And likewise with the cup. He poured the cup, he passed it among them, and said for each of them to remember his spilled blood for them on this earth.
Explanation to everyone. Our plates, collection plates, are at the back of the church, and they will be brought up during the church service, during the doxology. And if you want to give now at the back of the church or at the church, at either place, you're welcome to do so. Let's pray. Dear Lord, giver of all things, please help us to understand that the gifts that we give you, though minuscule, are put to great work with your help. Help us to understand that it's not how much we give, but it's the matter of our heart when we are doing the giving. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I think we're particularly pleased today that we have more men in the choir than we've had in a long time. I guess that's an extra praise from.
Yes.
Thank you.
this is from Leah Hall, a writer for Country Living on the internet. Whether you're looking to change up your life with some drastic new beginnings, or just thinking about swapping out the living room paint color, for some of us, change of any kind can be a little daunting. Even though we know that change is inevitable and usually a positive thing, we are by nature creatures of habit, so it can take a little prodding to get us to make a big move. The good news is that so many people out there have spoken about it and are willing to shed a little light at the end of the tunnel to give us comfort and motivation. One place that is always a sure source of encouragement toward growth is God's Word. The Bible has so much to say on the goodness of change and God's presence with you every step of the way. It may be hard, but you have a God who loves you and wants the best for you. Look to His Word, and He will offer guidance through uncertain times. Our scripture today is Philippians, the 4th chapter, the 6th and 7th verses. Do not worry about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. All these other tags are just a few of the scriptures, which I will cover some. Okay, so let's talk about the word change. As a verb, it's to make the form, nature, content, or future course of something different from what it is or from it would be if left alone. Okay? To become different. As a noun, the act or fact of changing or of being changed. A transformation or modification, an alteration. So I'm talking about trusting God during any of those things. Big ones, little ones, all kinds of things. Go to Him in prayer. Go to His book. Or do you really understand what trust means? As a noun, trust is reliance on the integrity, strength, ability, surety, and more of a person or thing. Confidence. Confident expectation of something. And here's a big word. Hope. As a verb, it's to rely or place confidence in someone or something. To have confidence, hope, and trust synonym is faith. So do you have faith in God during the things that make our lives different? Is what this sermon is, this message is. So first of all, let's talk about the types of change. Now, Leah Hall mentioned, you know, something big, and then she mentioned something as simple as making a change in the color of your living room paint. Okay, I went through that last spring, and it was not hard, but it wasn't easy. Did I go to God about it? No, I did not. I figured I was a big enough girl to handle the color of the paint in my living room by myself. Should I have gone to God? Probably would have speeded up the process a bit. Okay? So big ones or little ones, either one goes. Change that happened to us, though, are harder to accept to begin with, but then I guess as humans, we always have somebody else to blame it on. Okay? So there's something about it that when it happens to us, we kind of get down and handle it a little bit quicker sometimes. This week, we have experienced 4 instances of death in this community. TC. Most of us did not know her well, but I'm going to use some liberalness here and say, I think all of us saw a change in David. He was happier. He seemed like he could be nicer to everybody. Not that he wasn't always nice, but he was more comfortable in his own skin after he and TC got married. TC had a good effect on somebody that we know and care about. But he didn't ask for this to happen. And he's going to have to deal with a lot of change. Personally. And Susie's going to have to deal with a lot of change. And Ashley and Jenny as well. All of us, we know it's back there. We're dealing with it. But we need to pray for them and to help them with this change. Same thing, Billy Buck. Billy Buck died this week. He has members of the family that we all know and know well. We knew him well. It's a change. And for his family members, again, it might not be affecting us directly, but we need to help and guide them as God guides us on dealing with this major change that nobody asked for. Then we have Ethel Johnson, drove the school bus. Helen Tom. We know Helen. Many of us remember Ethel. There's a gap. There's a space that's missing here because of this change. And then, for those of you who know him or don't know him, David Daniels' father-in-law, Glenn Walker, died this week. I knew Glenn from long ago. And for those who else might need another connection, he's Jim Emmel's cousin. These are 4 deaths. None of us asked for it. And all of us are going to have to be dealing with the changes. Not his absence, our absence, but the changes that are going to affect all the people that we love. How do we do that? We go to God. Very simple. We go to God. Other changes that happen to us that sometimes we don't ask for, being fired or let go from a job, school starting. As much as you prepare for it all summer, when it gets here, you didn't ask for it. Or maybe some parents do ask for it. Okay? Whatever. It means that your schedule is going to change. And I know that there's one person in this room that really, really likes to have things on schedule. Right? Really likes for things to be done according to a schedule. And when that gets changed, some people handle it well, some people don't. Robbie was asking me this morning, well, how is he going to do this if this happens and this happens? I said, I don't know, Randy. I mean, I don't know, Robbie. You just do it. Maybe you call Randy and ask him for help. The whole thing of it is that school starting is going to be a big deal in some ways for Robbie and me. Blake is going to middle school. For some people, that's a scary time. What do you do? Pray about it. change stuff. Are we very nice about that? I can remember some things that myself have said and have heard other people say about what the weather is doing to our plans. Okay? That's something we need to learn how to deal with, because that's not going to change. It's going to always affect us. Illnesses. We don't ask to become ill. We don't ask for the trouble and the upheaval one of us being sick causes. So you're not just asking for relief from the illness, you're asking for relief from the changes. You can't go about doing your daily life like you were. Okay? And then, this is a big one that has been talked about before, is if a friend or family member decides to move away. It's not you directly that's having to face a lot of change, except for their absence. But boy, don't we all have opinions about that. But what should we be doing? We should be helping them and ourselves get used to this thing called change. You're not going to see them as often. You might have to make it a point to text more often, or to email, or phone call, God forbid. Okay? But then, here comes the big changes. The ones that are our decision. And all the thought process, and the guilt, and the what am I doing that goes along with our decisions to make a change. A few years ago, I stood up here and talked about change before. And it was when Eric was leaving. We had to do things differently. We had to deal with some things. Had we made the right decision? Had he made the right decision? What was going on? So we make some decisions, and personally, I did the change in jobs one about 5 years ago. I got told I was stupid. I got told, what in the world is wrong with you? I got told, it's time for you to retire. Don't you understand? Y'all would be surprised that who all said those things to me, and it wasn't him. But when we make a big decision like that, there are a lot of people that expect an explanation. And sometimes we just don't have an explanation. It's our decision. And can we live with it? And can we deal with the changes that it's going to cause? Where do we go for help? That part's simple. How about making the decision, I'm going to go away to school, Mom. As much as you want me to go to community college, I have decided I'm going to go away to school. Oh, that's a hard one. Because it does upheaval on everyone. Okay? This is one that I have been a part of also. It's a long time ago. Vacationing in a different place. If the family has gone to this one place over and over and over and over and over again, and then all of a sudden somebody says, well, let's change up. We're going to go to this place. Oh, my goodness. You would think that the world had come to an end. What's wrong with down there? I've always liked it down there. And not even thinking about how good it might be to go somewhere else. Changes. What about a divorce? Sometimes a divorce can be a surprise that happens to us. But if the person thinks, they probably realize that it was coming. And so then it's a decision process. That affects the whole family, friends, everybody. What side are you going to pick? How do you not pick? But it's change. Change is the hard part. How it affects us, what we have to do differently. In divorce, you have to watch what you say a little bit more, a little bit better. Maybe you have to be a little bit more sympathetic. And then sometimes maybe you need to be a little tougher. But you have to be paying attention when there's change going on. Then the little simple ones, not as simple as the painting of the living room, but lifestyle changes. What if you decide to go on a diet? And that means you're going to set aside a time that you're going to exercise, or time that you're going to go to bed, and that affects everybody else. Maybe the foods you fix aren't exactly the same as everybody's used to. Am I talking about little bitty changes? I am. I am talking about the little bitty changes. And if we can't handle the little bitty changes and don't feel like we can ask God for a little bit of help, do you think we have the right to ask Him to help us with the big stuff? We need to learn. We need to make a habit of asking for help. Whether it's something we came to the decision on, or whether it was a decision that was put on us. Things that change what we plan to do upset us as a general rule. Preachers of habit is what Leah Hall called us. How many people here, and I will raise my own hand on this, stayed in a job longer than I should have? Why? Because it was comfortable. It wasn't that bad. I can do this. Other people need me. You got all these things in the world, but it's comfort. We don't want to step out of our comfort zone. Even if it's not, your zone is not all that great. We don't want to step into the unknown. Because we don't like playing with something. But if you stay in the comfort zone, you just have to deal with the things you already know. Right? By the way, you should be asking God to help you deal with those things as well. Okay? So we're not talking about adding on anything we shouldn't already be doing. We just have to change the ask and the change to helping. So, do we understand? Change is little, change is great big, and it's everything in between. Where do you go for help? So we're going to go to some of these. Deuteronomy, the 31st chapter, the 6th verse. Be strong and bold. Have no fear or dread of them. Changes. Because it is the Lord your God who goes with you. He will not fail you or forsake you. Pretty simple. Ecclesiastes. And all of us know this because it's a song. Ecclesiastes 3, the first verse, and I'm not going to read all of it, I'm just going to read the first one. For everything there is a season and a time for every matter under heaven. Under heaven. God's helping you through it all. Then we have Isaiah. I love Isaiah. Chapter 43, verses 18 and 19. Pay attention. Do not remember the former things, or consider the things of old. I am about to do a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it? I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. God is expecting changes in us. God is expecting changes to happen on this earth. He's ready. He's ready. Then you have Daniel. Daniel's another one of my favorite things. Daniel, the second chapter, the 20th and 21st verses. And Daniel said, "Blessed be the name of God from age to age, for wisdom and power are his. He changes times and seasons, disposes kings and sets up kings. He gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to those who have understanding." Again, this is God's plan for there to be changes. 2 Corinthians, the 5th chapter, the 17th verse. "So if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new." When we get into a series of changes that we're not comfortable with them, look at them as a new creation, a new beginning. Go to God, but look at us new opportunities. Just this one more. In Ephesians, the 2nd chapter, the 8th and 9th verses. "For by grace you have been saved through faith." What is faith? Trust. Okay. "And this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not the result of works, so that no one may boast. For what we are, he has made us, created in Jesus Christ for good works, which God prepared beforehand to be our way of life." Now, that's what God has to say about it. What do people have to say about it that are just regular people? Hit a few of these. Winston Churchill said, "To improve is to change. To be perfect is to change often." It's expected. If you're going to grow, there are going to be changes. I don't think God wants us to be stagnant. I don't think he wants us to be the same thing in our faith, the same maturity level in our faith when we are 10, as we are when we are 60. There has to be growth, so therefore there must be change. Jack Welch, I love this, Jack Welch said, "Change before you have to. Be a little proactive. Anticipate what the changes are going to be expected of you and get there quickly before you have to do it." Okay, for everybody that's got gray hair, how do you feel about computers? Resisted it, didn't you? And then it came this way, whether you were ready or not. Change before you have to. John D. Rockefeller, "Don't be afraid to give up the good to go for the great." You don't know what change is going to bring. You can anticipate and you can trust that it will be good and probably better. Icelandic proverb, and they also said a Spanish saying, "A wise man changes his mind. A fool never will." Okay? The greatest discovery of all time is that a person can change his future by merely changing his attitude. The word attitude has taken on a meaning that technically is negative. You know, when we say someone has an attitude, you know, they're probably not behaving all that greatly, or they're being very outspoken or whatever. There's really nothing wrong with the word attitude or having an attitude. We all do. We all have an attitude about everything. But you don't change your attitude with things. Some things are never going to change. Leo Tolstoy said, true life is lived when tiny changes occur. How many of you notice things that are teeny tiny sometimes and they make you smile from one side to the other? Little bitty things. Some different, some you weren't expecting. It makes you smile. That's still change. It might be little bitty, it might be great, but it's still change. C. Joy Bell C. Well, I don't know who that is. Her quote is, you will find it necessary to let things go simply for the reason that they are heavy. Sometimes you just got to change. Maya Angelou, if you can't change it, change your attitude. That attitude thing. And then Abraham Maslow said, in any given moment, we have two options: to step forward into growth or to step back into safety. Where are we? We should be stepping forward all the time because we know we have somebody with us. We have book to read. We have wonderful sayings that other people around us have. You have friends. You have a church family. We know that we have a God that will be with us during change, whether it's little or whether it's great big. Help us to get our attitudes right by going to God. It's the simplest thing. It's easy. It's not hard. You just pick up the Bible and you start reading. Trusting in God during change. And for those of you who don't know what frog means, fully rely on God. Think about it. Fully rely on God. Then praying won't get hard. You do it all the time. It gets a whole lot easier. Asking other people for help is not a bad thing. And you get used to doing that too. You need to learn how to deal with change because it is inevitable. Whether we make it ourselves or whether it's God on us. But we do have somebody to go to on this ship. Our closing hymn is, open my eyes that I may see. Anyone wishing to join our church through confession of faith or transfer of membership may come forward during as we sing this hymn of invitation. And also, I will say now that all the church members, after the benediction, all the church members, please remain for a church meeting. So our closing hymn or hymn of invitation is number 563, Open My Eyes That I May See.
Yeah.
us, dear Lord, to come to you with questions of how we maneuver through these changes. Be with those again, dear Lord, that could not be with us today, and help them to return when it be thy will. Amen.